present to the previous talks, I thought I would have been better off with that as my title, and now for something completely different. I think I find already one person who recognizes that statement. It's from the Monty Python show. It's a British comedy group, and it's followed by a man playing piano with his teeth. And I'll do something close, though not exactly that. So this is joint work with Rahul Jain, who is in USC, and his student Dilip Kalathil, who is now a postdoc at Berkeley. Okay, so this is the outline. At the risk of boring the experts, I'll go through a lot of basics for maybe half or two-thirds of the talk. Talk about Markov decision process, value iteration, Q-value iteration, which you have heard about a bit, in maybe a little more detail. Talk about the classical Q-learning and then the new variant, which is without stochastic approximation. I also embedded some introduction to stochastic approximation somewhere. So this is my basic object, the controlled Markov chain. This is a random process taking discrete values, let's say, this, without loss of generality. Label them as 1 to S. It's also a finite action space, A1 to AD. And A valued control process Zn. So Zn takes values A1 to AD. Xn takes values 1 to S. And the control Markov chain is specified by this transition matrix. So this stands for probability of going from I to J when you choose action U. Probability that the next state is I, given the entire history, depends only on where you are now and what control you use right now. It doesn't depend on what happened before time N. So this function specifies the probability of going to state I when you are at Xn and you use the control Zn. So with some jargon. So I should say that, the broadest class of controls that you'll consider is whatever satisfies the previous dynamics I wrote on the previous slide. That would be called a general admissible control, but one generally is interested in more restricted classes. So one is what's called randomized stationary Markov control. Here the idea is that you specify the probability of choose a probability distribution on the control space. It depends only on the current state. So perhaps I should go back to the previous slide. So here Xn and Zn were both random variables. Xn is the state which the process is in. And the idea now is that I call it a stationary randomized control if I choose Zn randomly, but the probability distribution depends only on Xn. I don't use any information from the past. And stationary Markov, if it's, you do something even simpler, namely just take a function of the state. So when you are in Xn, use the function Zn to be equal to some function V of Xn, where V is some prescribed map from state space to action space. And then stick to discounted cost. So you want to minimize infinite horizon discounted cost. Given the function of the control sequence, where beta is the discount factor between 0 and 1, which in particular ensures that this sum is well defined. C is some prescribed running cost function. So Cxn Zm is the cost you pay at time m if you are in state Xm and choose the control Zm. So now the standard sort of textbook approach is to use dynamic programming. You define the minimum cost to go or value function as a function of state given by this equation. So V of I is the minimum cost to go if you start at I. So it will allow admissible control policies of the corresponding cost. And then you know the dynamic program principle. What it says is the minimum cost to go from I is minimum over what you pay immediately and the discount factor times the expected minimum cost from next stage onwards. So it's kind of one step analysis. Probably most of you have seen it. So this is a dynamic programming equation, and furthermore, one knows that if this minimum is attained at some, so the minimum is over U, so it will depend on I. So suppose it's attained at V star of I, then V star defines the stationary Markov policy, which is optimal. So if you choose Zn to be V star of Xn, it will be optimal. So all this is standard. So the reason for going through this is, thanks to the final comment, if you have a solution V, you perform the minimization here and you get the optimal policy. So one needs, wants to learn what V is, and one approach is what's called value-bit iteration. So if I look at the dynamic programming equation as a fixed point equation, so it's of the form V equal to FV. So what it means is that V is a fixed point of the map F, where F is defined in this way. So it's a fixed point equation of a map from RS to S dimensional space to S dimensional space. And one can check that it satisfies this property where this norm sub infinity stands for the usual the max norm. So just the maximum of absolute value. Max over I mod x I. And this is enough to ensure that if you simply iterate this map, so if you start with some V0 and define V1 equal to FP0, V2 equal to FV1 and just go on iterating Vn plus 1 is FVn, which is nothing but this equation, this iteration, it will converge exponentially to the desired solution. Okay. So that follows from something called fixed point theorem. And since V is what we want, this serves as a algorithm for computing V, and it's known as value iteration scheme. This is one of the algorithms, not only one. There are policy iteration and linear programming, two equivalent linear programming formulations, which I won't get into. Now this is fine as long as you know the if it's a nice problem in the sense that if you know the transition probabilities explicitly and problem size is not too big, then it's fine. But if either P is unknown or it's known but it's too messy, then it may not be all that convenient despite the exponential convergence guarantees and so on. So what one would like to do is probably simulate. So sometimes simulation is easy. So for example, typically when you're looking at a network of large number of simple systems, but once they're interconnected, it's kind of unwieldy, but individually they may be simple. So of course, I should have maybe started by mentioning that I'm not a computer scientist, I'm from E background, so the kind of things that would come to my mind is this. So it's not this situation scenario is not uncommon in the communication networks, etc. Okay, so this has motivated a lot of simulation-based optimization schemes for, simulation-based schemes for approximate dynamic programming. So this is the control theorist perspective of reinforcement learning as opposed to AI. Okay, so and there are multiple names which mean, at least in this context, mean roughly the same thing. And the basic idea is to use the classical iterative schemes like value, sort of draw inspiration from classical iterative schemes like value iteration or policy iteration or even occasionally linear programming, but come up with sort of sample based schemes using what's known as stochastic approximation, which is the kind of standard paradigm for recursive stochastic computations, which I'll soon describe in some more detail. So before I do that, let me mention what Q learning is. So Q learning is a simulation based scheme for approximate dynamic programming. So I think this is different from the year which Sridhar gave, that 1989 is the thesis. I think the paper appeared, if I'm not mistaken, in 1992. So one defines Q values. Now what I have put here is simply, if I go back, simply this term in the square bracket, whatever you are minimizing, I call that Qi, comma U. So Vi is min over U of Qi, comma U. Okay. So that's of course the first observation here. And then if I plug this back in here, I get a self-consistent equation for Q itself. And one can think of this as a dynamic programming equation for Q values. We should stand here. Then again, it's a fixed point equation, Q equal to G of Q for appropriately defined G, and that turns out to be a contraction as well. And you can write a Q value iteration, which will converge exponentially to the unique solution, so everything goes through smoothly. furthermore, we start the minimizer of or the second argument gives you the optimization macro problem policy. So it's similar to what we had for value iteration, but then the question is why bother? So now suppose you had the state space which is S dimension, and action space for D dimension, I have blown up the size of the problem. Okay. So why would one want to do that? So here I have said there's no a priori you don't feel there's any reason to do so. Make the problem harder, but the reason is that there's one difference. So stare at this equation and perhaps quickly go back to the previous one. Look at this. This the big difference is that the min and the expectation have changed places. Okay, the minimization is the nonlinear operation one is doing that has gone inside the conditional averaging. Because of which one can use an incremental stochastic approximation. Stochastic approximation does the averaging for you. So it's good to have averaging outside of everything else, which is now possible. And you can have a simulation-based scheme with one standard selling point of stochastic approximation is that generally, it can be slow as I have pointed out here, but you typically don't compute a whole lot per iterate. So like this short tutorial on stochastic approximation, this goes back to 1951 Robbins-Monroe scheme, which is of this form. So their motivation was to solve the equation Hx equal to 0 point, the roots of a nonlinear function, given noisy measurements. So they're statisticians, and for them, this was just a noisy measurement of Hxn. So you don't know either this or this. What you know is the sum. So think of this as a noise. So given a black box which on input x gives hx plus noise, you want to solve the equation hx equal to 0, and they came up with this iterative scheme. Okay, so forget it. This is basically the history till n. So the conditions, so for noise the condition one imposes is that's what's called a martingale difference. Because what it means is that it's uncorrelated with all the past. So conditional expectation of mn, expectation of mn plus 1 times z will be 0 for any z which depends on only the history up to time n. That's roughly the idea, or if you are comfortable with this, conditional expectation of mn plus 1 given history till n is 0. So such processes are called basically sequence of random variables uncorrelated with the past. But the major innovation was this step size choice. So they chose positive step sizes satisfying these two. The sum of n is infinity, sum of n square is finite. So n goes to 0 but not very fast. Okay, this is a technical condition one needs. So the conditional variance is bounded by the current previous iterate or the current value of xn. Now I have added this comment for the following reason. See, this gives me the impression that you are thinking of additive noise, which is kind of restricted, which is not the case. Because I have not assumed that this is IID, it's just a martingale difference, and you can fit other things into this. So typically iteration will look like this. It will be some function xn, comma, some IID noise. Then all you have to do is to define hx as freeze x and average out over the noise, call that hx, and define mn plus 1 as fxn comma xn plus 1 minus hx. So you are just subtracting off conditional expectation of this given everything up to time. So it automatically becomes uncorrelated. So you sort of, you are subtracting out whatever depended on the past till n. So it's a very general framework. I'll just describe the differential equation based approach. So the original Robbins-Monroe used strictly probabilistic arguments. That 50s, then there are a lot of other work in late 50s and 60s, but this came in early 70s. So what these guys did was to think of it as a noisy discretization of the differential equation. So if you simulate this differential equation computer, you would write xn plus 1 is xn plus a times hxn, constant step size. That's the Euler scheme for numerical analysis. So you can think of this as an Euler scheme with a slowly decreasing time step and noise. Noisy Euler scheme for the differential equation. So one can hope that the differential equation somehow captures the behavior of the algorithm, and that turns out to be true under at least stable equilibrium x star, then what one can show typically is that if the interest don't blow up, then they will converge to the x star. And okay, so let me first explain this. So this left hand side needs separate test. So this is something we learned from pre-EO2. Verify it separately. There's no universal trick for doing that, but there are various kind of different sufficient conditions which one can use. Usually not very hard in at least a standard reinforcement learning problem, but can be bad in sometimes. And if you cannot verify this, then what people typically do is to sort of project it back into some large bounded set, and then you have to modify the analysis a bit. But that can also be handled. Now the reason this happens is the following. So you can, as I said, you can think of the iterate as a iteration is a noisy discretization of the differential equation. So the two sources of error, one is that you are discretizing it, so that itself introduces error, and there's noise as well. And because the discretization step is going to zero asymptotically, the error due to discretization goes to zero. And the noise is also being multiplied by n. So suppose, let's say mn was iid 0 means, say, okay, your the total noise you are adding is sum of n times mn plus 1. The variance of that would go as sum of n square times something, okay, the order of n square. And the condition, the second condition, we have imposed the sum of n square is finite, ensures that perturbation due to noise also goes asymptotically to zero. So this, if you think of the iteration as an approximation or of the differential equation, that approximation gets better and better as the time goes on, because of which you are able to say that this will happen. And this also explains why you need to, so as I said, sum of n square being finite ensure that discretization and noise error go to zero. But why do you need sum of n equal to infinity? And that's because you are trying to track the asymptotic behavior of the differential equation. So you should cover the entire time axis. So that's ensured by the first condition, the sum of n is infinity. Okay, I forgot that I actually had slides on this. So anyway, the standard way one proves this is just define new time instants like this. So t0 is 0, say t1 is a1, t2 is a1 plus a2, etc. And plot, define this piecewise linear function x bar t, which is defined at this time instance to you match it with your iterates and interpolate linearly. And you compare that to the differential equation trajectory over some window. And I don't know how many are people have control background. This is kind of bread and butter for control. You apply Grunewald and bound the error between the interpolated iterates and the differential equation trajectory in terms of the discretization error and error due to noise. And these two go to zero asymptotically because of the conditions on n, as I just said. And then one can use these, there are various ways of concluding from this. So as I said, you compare the differential equation and the iterates over a moving window. Cannot compare on the entire time axis and expect the error to remain bounded. But that's enough. And there are various ways of proving. The Lyapunov argument is easy, because if the Lyapunov function decreases along the differential equation, then on any fixed patch where the two trajectories are closed, if it decreases by, say, capital delta over along the differential equation, it will decrease by, say, delta by 2 along the algorithm. That's enough. So it cannot keep on decreasing forever. So you get a convergence that you want. You know, this probably will mean something when I'm talking away, but depends on how familiar you are with Lyapunov and such things. For control people, it's quite routine. Okay, so let's go back to Q-learning. So the way you go from the iterative algorithm to stochastic approximation version is this. First thing you do is to replace the, so we have this conditional average featuring on the right. As I said, the advantage of going from V to Q was that this, I interchanged the order of min and P, this average. So for a value iteration, this was inside, now it's outside. So you get rid of this and replace, instead plug in a simulated random variable with the desired conditional loss. So I'm assuming you have some box which generates this is random variable subsimulator which will give you this kind of random variables. And of course, if you simply replace this by this in the Q value iteration, it will be somewhat, it will be an unstable situation. It will be something like a random program. So you have to kind of damp out the randomness. So you replace the full move by an incremental move. So you take a convex combination of the previous iterate and the correction term with a slowly decreasing weight. So you get something like this. So I have taken the new Q value is the convex combination of the previous value plus n times what the Q value iteration suggests, except that I have replaced the conditional expression with an actual evaluation at a simulated random variable. So if I reorganize and connect together the terms involving n, it looks like this. You can just by inspection, you can write down the differential equation which looks like this. And this is a contraction map, and one can show that this will converge to the unique fixed point as it's an asymptotically stable equilibrium. In fact, this works as a Lyapunov function. This is not differentiable as one usually requires Lyapunov function to be, but doesn't matter. One can still prove that it will monotonically decrease along the trajectory to zero. And stability also, there's a separate test to prove that. So you can show a priori that the iterates will remain bounded. And then the argument described for stochastic approximation earlier guarantees that this will converge to the desired Q value. This is synchronous, so I am assuming here, so I mentioned that this is synchronous, so in the sense that I am simultaneously updating all components of Q. But typically, particularly for online situations, you run a single chain, so at each time n you have one xn and one zn, and you update only one component, and that looks like this. So this is a slightly different, so this is indicator function, so I of xn equal to I, zn equal to u is 1 if xn is I and zn is u and 0 otherwise. So if either of these is not true, that xn is not I or zn is not u, then qn plus 1 iu is qn iu. Don't change it at all. Just pick one component and update it according to this. Now you can analyze the limiting body and you get something sticking in front. I mean, this x0t equal to gxt minus xt was the previous differential equation. You get a diagonal matrix with non-negative entries on the diagonal sitting in front of it. And I mean, this is kind of a loose intuition. It's something like this happens because they are not being sampled equally often. You know, so some xn may be visited, so say xn equal to 1 is visited twice as often as xn equal to 2, or zn equal to u is sampled only occasionally. So as it was mentioned in the previous lectures, when you use it as an online, because you also want to learn, I mean you need to continue exploring. Even if your algorithm tells you that something, say, u star is the best candidate now for your optimal choice, current best guess for optimal choice, what you would typically do is choose u star with probability 1 minus epsilon, and with epsilon you choose something else at random. Otherwise, you won't sample everything often enough, and you won't learn basically. So I have not written down those things, but these issues remain. So they may not be picked up comparably often, so this lambda t somehow reflects that relative frequency. So typically something which is sampled very frequently will have a large component in the diagonal, and something which is not will have a small component. But I said there is not an exact intuition because there is this time scaling involved in going from the actual clock time n to what I call tn, sum of ai from 1 to n. So modulo the time scaling, it's something like relative frequency. And typically, what most people would do, and certainly I do all the time, is to ensure some condition to say that these remain bounded away from zero, and then the convergence goes through. There's some little more work needed, but it's not hard. So if all the diagonal, the time-dependent terms on the diagonal, but as long as they're bounded away from zero, some extra work can still prove convergence, and therefore this will converge almost surely. Now this, so this is all pairs I are sampled comparably offered. Now this is a beautiful paper by Jenny Yu and Bertsikas, where she showed that just sampling infinitely often is enough. Very difficult piece of work, Vitalizing. Okay, so now I am trying to sell what comes next, which is the Q learning without stochastic approximation. That, like all stochastic approximations, this is also slow. But of course, it's not free. I'll be giving up something else. So here, in particular, this is offline, whatever I'm going to talk about now. So one fixes number n, number of samples per stage, and the algorithm is essentially the Q value iteration. What one does is take n samples, take the empirical transition probability. So I generated, instead of generating one psi I comma u according to the transition probability of pj given I comma u, I generate n id samples of it and take this average and just plug it in. There's no, it's not incremental, so it's no stochastic approximation. Okay, so these are for fixed IU, they have this distribution, and otherwise they're independent. Yes, so this is not an, so I'm assuming you have some simulator which will do that for you. It's not an online scheme. I cannot do that with a single simulation. Yeah, you'll have to generate n samples each day. Okay, so essentially I'm doing the Q value iteration with some estimate of P plugged in. And one can, of course, this is just you can interpret this as this empirical probability of the P-Dyn probability of going to J from I given U is just the empirical frequency of that event in this n samples which you generated. And for a fixed sample, so this is word I borrowed from statistical physics. So what I'm going to think of this as, suppose I generate, run this algorithm forever, then for each sample path I will have this sequence of random stochastic matrices P1, P2, P3. I freeze them, just freeze their sample path. Now think of it as a frozen randomness. So this is just a sequence of non-stationary sequence of random matrices which is presented to you. So you're doing the Q value iteration, but with some approximations of actual transition probability, which are time dependent. And the claim is that, first time, of course, consistency, you get the correct answer. And this is the empirical observation. I did not put a figure in the slides, but it's quite easy to describe what happens. So suppose your original algorithm goes to, let's say this is the Q value, zero. Suppose it goes like this. This one goes down extremely fast and then becomes extremely slow. And with fairly small n, capital N is maybe 5, 10, even with that it does this. And why this, I don't know, but I can prove convergence, that's all. No, this is not.
Some policy that gives you enough exploration for all the state actors. Okay. Can you somehow wait for the end time you visit an action pair and
converge it to that? Yeah. It should be possible. I mean, I haven't thought about it. There are some other issues also. I'll talk about it later. But this is this initial drop is quite impressive. Yeah, it improves with n certainly. I mean, it's not independent of n, but it. But it will become bad if n is very low. It won't look so nice. But it becomes pretty good, pretty fast. Say n equal to 10, it'll already become good.
The x-axis is the number of iterations or number of samples.
You know, this is number of iterations.
So
Yeah, this improves with the number of samples. So if I just take even more samples, it may become even better, something like this.
Right, but then the number of
samples will increase, yeah. Total number of samples will increase.
Multiply by N, right?
Yeah. I don't think we're not to check that. This is just against the time. Yeah. No, this is currently, I'm talking only about the synchronous. We're doing this for everybody. So right now it's an academic exercise. There's a lot more we have to do. It's not a... It won't be immediately... So that's why we feel is that one could do this for a while and then switch. But the initial drop is very fast. That's the interesting. Yeah, so it's the empirical transition probability. You just
What kind of experiment is carried out there? Like, which setting was this observed?
I have to check. I can tell you later.
Yeah. Is it a random entity setting or a particular setting?
I need to check because I was not involved in the simulation. Yeah, but it's changing with time. So you have to think of the forward iteration as going backward. That's the key. So the value iteration actually goes like this. So suppose I am here. Think of it, so suppose this is n. The vn has the interpretation of, so see, here I have written it from 0 to n. In fact, it would have been more clear if I had written it from minus n to 0. Okay, so suppose I am here, and the v0 is my terminal cost, and v star m, xm would have been chosen here. Okay, according to something. Then the next iteration, I go from minus n to minus, actually, in reality, I'm going from n to n plus 1, but here I would go from minus n to minus n minus 1. Now, at this point, this horizon has not changed. So, this particular function remains the same. That's the point. And the same thing one can say for the q value iteration. So, you can think of it as the q value of a finite horizon problem if you look backwards. Yeah, I think this is better. So if you think of it in this fashion, minus n to minus 1, things are more clear. So it's clear that if I go from minus n to minus n minus 1, whatever I had seen till now, the remaining horizon from minus n to 0 has not changed if I go from minus n to minus n minus 1. So it's kind of consistently, you can go backwards. Now I consider two iterates with two different initial conditions, say, and initial conditions at minus n. So I start at minus n with two different initials and consider the associated state control process which are optimal, and the claim is that they couple. And of course you need irreducibility, apodicity, etc. But I will try to give you intuition for that, and intuition comes from something else. Okay, it's actually the prop Wilson idea. Again, for exact sampling, some of you might have heard of it. So let me draw a picture for that. It's a very beautiful idea. So if you are familiar with Markovitch and Monte Carlo, what one does is run a, suppose you want to estimate the stationary average of some function f of Markovitch chain, say. Okay, so what one typically does is run the Markovitch chain, take the empirical average, and this will converge to the stationary average, okay, where pi is the stationary distribution. So if you run it long enough, you are close to this. That's all you can say. You cannot say you are exactly here. But prop Wilson gives you a sample which is exactly distributed according to the stationary distribution. The way they do it is as follows. So you have to go backwards. So it lists, so this is 0, minus 1, minus 2. So replicate the state at each time. And for each time at each state, you generate something like what we have, generate a sample. Suppose I generated, so generate independently transitions like this. Suppose it went here, this went here, this went here again, this went here, and so on. Okay, so, and again repeat, go back one step and repeat it again. Okay, suppose I start somewhere at minus n and trace one path. Suppose let's start here. Suppose I trace this path. For simplicity, let me replace this by this. Okay. I trace this path, it came here. I trace this path and they met here. Okay. So what's happening is that suppose it went on like that. So, although at each time, at each state, I am generating one independent transition, these two, if I just trace their future from this point on, they meet here and thereafter they will move together. And there are finitely many states, so if I go sufficiently far back, suppose at this point, I find that all these So coupled by this point, say. Okay. And once they are coupled, they remain coupled. So what would be the distribution of that? So suppose this is minus m. So it's the distribution of the m step Markov chain. But it wouldn't matter if I went further back. Okay, they would have also coupled by this time. So it is as good as having started the chain at minus infinity. So the distribution is already the stationary distribution. So the first time this backward simulation, this is called backward coupling, first time they meet, it's exactly the stationary distribution. And this is what they propose for generating a sample with exactly stationary distribution. Of course, this is impractical. But one place where it found use is in the statistical mechanics kind of situations. For example, Ising model, you can define a partial order by saying that two configurations, one dominates the other if wherever the, say, A dominates B, if wherever B has a plus, A also has a plus. Okay. In which case, there's the maximal element, all pluses, minimal element, all minuses. And if you take those as initial conditions and they couple, everything else in between would have coupled, so you don't have to simulate it. So for Markov chains with this special structure, this can be used. Otherwise, it's not a practical idea, but it can generate in a finite random time a sample which is exactly distributed as pi. So it's the same proof, same idea we use for proof. You just start couple these problem things, and that in particular shows that if you start with two different conditions, initial conditions, they couple, this converges. So you just, okay, the proof is minor afterwards. So you write this Qn, Iu as this added, subtracted, that beta Q at n, and just iterate. And you get things which can show remain, will converge. The last term will go to zero, the middle term. See, this difference term remains bounded because of the coupling. And therefore, that's the middle summation also converges. And the first term, of course, converges. So you know that it goes someplace, it converges. Now the question is whether the conversion, what it converges is what you want. Okay, right now I just claim convergence. So we have to use something called, there's this famous paper called Merging of Opinions with Increasing Information by Blackwell and Dubins, and which is this key lemma. So what they show is essentially that if you have two apps, this lemma is used in that paper. So if Yn is some bounded sequence of random variables which is convergent, and you have some sequence of sigma fields increasing or decreasing, doesn't matter, then conditional expression of Yn given Fn converges to that of Y given F. So now I have this. I just take a conditional expectation. This is measurable with respect to the way it pulls out. Now this is exactly same as this. Okay, just write it out. And therefore, again, if I pass the limit in this, what I get is that the limiting equation satisfies the and the DB equation for Q value, and therefore it's the correct solution, because the solution was unique. Yeah, so this is as you have been observing, it's a faster convergence. The larger the n, faster the convergence, and fewer the, of course, you are jacking up the computational effort quite a bit. Should also mention that as an aside, this is some ancient paper. It was resurrected recently in a kind of major development which may interest some of you. So this, when you have a, if you are have a partially observed Markov decision process, or partially observed Markov chain, uncontrolled, then you can recursively estimate the state by the corresponding log, use Bayes' rule. That gives you this nonlinear filter which recursively estimates the state. So if the chain is ergodic, that does not mean that the process of conditional laws is ergodic, but there are easy counterexamples. And that was an open issue for a long time. There was an incorrect proof by Kunita in 73, and somebody found the error in 80s or 90s, and a lot of people were trying to do this. It was finally resolved by a guy now in Princeton called Raman Panhandle, and he used this lemma. Your conditions for ergodicity of nonlinear filters. So suddenly a long forgotten lemma has again become quite popular. Okay, so as I said, we are really beginning. So there we have made some noises about asynchronous versions and more complexity, but we need to do more. And in the paper, there's a bit of both. Other cost criteria, this may be doable, like average cost, etc. The hardest problem, I think, will be this. Because the way this proof goes, I have tagged, see, you look at this picture. These are states. Okay. If I go to function approximation, I'm updating the coefficients. There's a different object altogether. Cannot make this association anymore. Don't know how one would go about it, but if one could do this with function approximation, that would be very useful. This might be the end. It is my favorite quotation about learning from a famous British philosopher of last century. Bounded away from zero. So number of times you updated a component till n divided by n, that should remain bounded away from zero.